dismissed to the back door.
While the children are dismissing, please open your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. And if you were not able to bring a Bible with you this morning, we do have plenty of those available around in the auditorium. And so they're the black books under the chair racks. And if you see somebody that doesn't have a Bible, it'll be just fine to grab one and even open it up to Romans chapter 12 and hand it to them so that they would have that convenience. We do want you to know that what is preached from the pulpit is preached from God's Word. And that is vitally important, because the truth of the matter is, if God didn't say it, it doesn't really have much meaning. And there are a lot of things that seem brilliant, motivational, or philosophical, if you will, thrilling and that sort of thing. But the reality is that if God didn't say it, it doesn't really matter much, does it? And so if you found Romans chapter 12 in the Bible, in your Bible this morning, I would like to go ahead and read beginning in verse 4. And we're going to read down to verse 8, just four verses in our text this morning in Romans chapter 12. And this is, if I could just preface before we even read our text this morning, this is, I believe, a portion of the Scripture that is so vitally important to a Christian's understanding of not only what is God doing, but how do they fit in God's plan in life. And it's so vital, but I think most Christians don't understand it. I believe most Christians have a very, very shallow base understanding of Romans chapter 12. And I believe the majority of Christians are disobedient in this area. And so I would ask you to pay close and careful attention this morning, because I believe that this could be a breakthrough for many believers by understanding this portion of Scripture. Here we are in Romans chapter 12, and we're going to begin reading in verse 4. The Bible says, "For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil, cleave that which is good." Okay, so verse 9 really breaks into the manner of how that we exercise spiritual gifts. But our text really is verses 4 through 8. Okay, so let's pray. Let's ask God to help us with our understanding this morning. Let me just say as well, if there is someone that you know is missing in the service this morning, we will have this message recorded. And I think everyone in our church needs to listen to this particular message in order to be effective as being a church member and effective in serving the Lord. So let's pray and let's ask God's help this morning, shall we? Father, we do need help. Lord, we do not need man's wisdom. We do not need man's opinions. But we absolutely do need to know your will and your purpose for our lives. And so I ask that you would bless us with truth this morning from your word. Lord, that there would not be human hindrances to the preaching of your word this morning, myself or any other. But rather instead, we ask that your Holy Spirit would teach us these truths so that we could be what we're supposed to be. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So one of the themes that right away comes up in Romans as we've been preaching through it and studying it, one of the early themes that we've run into is the theme of to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And really that is the best description of verse 4, for we have many members in one body and all members have not the same office. One of the things that the Apostle Paul, of course the Holy Spirit is using Paul, to point out is that everybody's different. And things that are different, we know, are not the same. And that's one of the struggles for unity in the church at Rome. One of the struggles for unity is that, you know, the gospel really got to Rome from Jews, from believing Jews. And when they preached the gospel to the Gentiles who received it, then all of a sudden the dynamic of the church changed. They were made up not just of Jewish believers, but Jewish and Gentile believers, and there was a natural friction between those two elements. The Gentiles really owed the preaching of the gospel, of course, to Jesus Christ, but the human element to preach the gospel to them were Jews. And so they really had a debt of gratitude to the Jews, but the Jews really felt like, because of what they had been completed in Jesus Christ, they felt like the believing Gentiles ought to be exactly like them, which we all think people ought to be like us. Wouldn't the world be nicer if everyone were like me? for instance. You know, everybody has this opinion. You know, this is my vantage point, my viewpoint, and the way I see the world is how everybody ought to see things. And that really does make a lot of sense to me, and I hope it makes as much sense to you. Probably not so much. Okay, but having said that, so the Jewish believers really felt as though the Gentiles needed to, you know, become Jewish. They needed to be circumcised. They needed to come under the law of Moses and so forth. And we really spent a great deal of time in Romans dispensing with the notion, to quote Marco Rubio, dispensing with the notion that salvation is by any means other than faith and faith alone. Matter of fact, do this sometime. If you're one of these people that study words, study the word faith, and you'll find that it occurs an unbelievable amount of times in Romans. And one of the reasons is it's one of the element, one of the themes of Romans. It's called in Romans 3 the law of faith. And so it literally is the means for salvation. We are saved by faith and not by the works of the law. And so a lot of time is spent by the Apostle Paul really dealing with the fact that the law is helpful, and he showed us what the law was helpful for. That is that the law helps to make sin exceeding sinful, was one of the illustrations. In other words, from Adam till Moses, death reigned, right? In other words, people died before Moses' law. But Abraham, he believed God, the Bible says, and his faith was counted for righteousness. So if Abraham were saved by faith, Moses' law did not yet exist, then salvation, at least in Abraham's day, was by faith, and salvation has always been by faith. And so the law doesn't save, but the law is a help, because it shows us what sin is. In other words, I don't need to know every sin that God condemns or God is against in order to die and be eternally separated from God. But it does help to know what sin is. It helps people when they tell you something like, I'm a good person. It helps them to see things from God's perspective rather than their own, right? Because we always have a reason for what we do. We always feel like, well, I did the wrong thing, but I had a reason for it. Here's why I did that. And we feel as though we're justified, but we don't see it how God sees it. You know, when you do something wrong and the other person is wronged, he doesn't see it from your perspective. He sees evil as evil, and you're the one that did it, and he sees you then as evil, right? And so it's good to have God's law to shed light on what sin is. A person may say, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with this, but when we see God condemns it, then all of a sudden, okay, it's wrong. It's always amazing when I meet someone, I ask them if they're going to heaven, and they'll say something to me like, yes, and I ask why, and they'll say, well, I'm a good person. And, you know, I show them, you know, the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God is perfect. God's standard is perfection. Would you say you're perfect? And I've had some people say, yeah, pretty much. And then I'll turn to someone who knows them, like a spouse or a child, and I'll say, are they perfect? And all of a sudden, a different perspective, of course, gives a different answer. And people will say, well, certainly not. No, they're not perfect, unless they're afraid to say it, in which case you can really tell they're not perfect. So why are they afraid of you if you're perfect? You know. And so, anyway, those things are a help. But there's a friction going on in the church, and Paul has just spent a good amount of time helping the believers at Rome to understand that God is working through the church, and God is going to work through Israel. Matter of fact, in Romans chapter 11 and verse 26, we saw, so all Israel shall be saved and shall come to the knowledge of the truth. You read the Revelation, you find out when those events are going to take place. So the day is going to come when Israel nationally, 100% as a nation, follows God in a way that they never have before. And God's going to work through Israel. But my friend, what Paul concludes in Romans 11 is that today God isn't working through Israel. Today, Israel that are saved are part of God's plan, which is Christ's church. Now this brings us into our passage of Scripture. Last week we kind of introduced, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And the Bible goes on to say, which is your reasonable service. And we are presented that as Jews and Gentiles, having been grafted into the true branch, which if the lump is holy, the whole thing is holy. If the branch is if the root be holy, then so are the branches. So we're grafted into this institution that God is working with, and we're made holy, that we belong as part of it, Jews and Gentiles. Now we see, okay, so how do we, being different, particularly in this church, Roman, in the church at Rome, how do we fit, how do we belong in the body? And Christian, I just want to say that as we begin reading in verse 6, and we see that the Bible says, having then gifts, differing according to the grace that's given to us, I want to remind us that it's imperative that we remind ourselves continually not to discourage someone simply because we don't have the grace to understand their need. When we look at the word grace here, it's an important word. Grace, certainly we have acrostics that have been used. You ever heard of God's riches at Christ's expense? Most people understand grace that way. Grace could be simply defined as God's supernatural power. In other words, I cannot, but God can, and God gives me the grace to do what I cannot do. And as a believer, if you've been saved and grown in grace and grown in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have certainly been faced with times when literally you did things that were beyond you, were past you, and it was because of God's grace, God's graciousness in your life. Grace has a lot of different contexts. Grace has a context in salvation, but grace also has many contexts that have to do with God's power in the Christian life. We're saved by grace, and we continue in grace. And so, now, we understand, though, and I just want to point this out. This isn't the message this morning, but I want to point out that as believers, it's important for us to understand that the Scripture begins here by saying that we have gifts that are differing according to the grace that's given to us. And so as much as we think someone ought to be like ourselves and somebody ought to respond or behave the way that we do to something, or someone ought to serve the Lord the way that we serve the Lord, one of the things we have to be reminded of is God's grace. I have many times seen believers going through a very difficult situation, and another believer come to them and say, "I just don't know how you can do it." You ever seen this before? And I know we mean sympathy when we say something like that, but the reality of it is one of the things we're questioning is God's grace for them. In other words, God gave them grace differing from my grace. One of the things that we really ought to be careful about with our words because of what it says about our God is to say to somebody, "I just don't know how you could go through that. I don't know." You know, and many times we discourage somebody from doing the right thing because we say that we couldn't do it. Well, of course we couldn't do it. We don't have God's grace to do it. But if they're in the circumstance, we know what the Bible says about it, right? "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you be tempted above that you're able, but will also, with the temptation, give you or provide you a way of escape." We know in James chapter 1, the Bible says that we are, "My brethren, if any man," diverse temptations. "Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations." That's what James says. When you fall into a difficult time, a diverse, whatever the different kinds of temptations are, count it all joy. How many people can be joyous in hardship? Woohoo! You know? Wow! You know, there was a double whammy. I just lost the person I love the most, and this just happened to me. Yay! Well, the Bible says, "If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth all men liberally." And that's a good example of God's wisdom or God's graciousness. God's giving to someone that which they don't have the ability to. You don't have the ability to do what you're commanded to in that context. You don't know how to be joyous in a hard occasion. But God gives you grace. God gives you the wisdom. God gives you the ability to do it. And so I want to remind us, before we look at the gifts that God describes here for the church, I want to remind you that you and I ought to be very, very careful about how we describe or how we deal with folks that are going through circumstances that we ourselves are not going through. Many, many times I've been put in situations where other folks have said to me, "I don't think you can do it. I don't think that'll work." And the reason they don't think that is because they haven't been given the grace or the gifts that are differing according to every person. Right? And so I want us to be mindful that the first thing that's pointed out in our text this morning is differences. As we grow in our faith, time and experience is going to give us the painful opportunity to be stretched, crushed, purified, and ultimately molded into Christ's image. And that's a process, my friend, that requires God's grace. God's grace is a gift, and it is wholly supernatural. There's nothing about God's grace that can be humanly explained. There's nothing about God's grace that can be carelessly or without a purpose experienced. In other words, God gives you grace that you need, but He doesn't give you grace you don't need. Okay, so because today we're going to look at, or I was going to say, in the church, every one of us bears And this is where I want you to really start paying attention, because we're going to get into our text now. In the church, every one of us bears responsibility to share our gracious or grace gifts with others, or as part of the team. I don't know if you follow basketball very much. It's perfectly fine if you don't. It isn't really worth following very much. But NBA basketball this year is pretty interesting if you're a Miami Heat fan, isn't it, Rolando? They're playing pretty well. And what's interesting right now is that everybody's having a most valuable player conversation about who's the most valuable basketball player this year. And Russell Westbrook is the name that comes up first, because he's putting up what's called triple-doubles. And he's really having an amazing year, but his team isn't doing very well. And then Kawhi Leonard's in the conversation right now. He plays for the San Antonio Spurs. And he's playing very, very well, and his team is also doing fantastic. And then James Harden is another one who plays for the Rockets, and he's putting up really big numbers, and his team is doing subpar. The debate right now is whether a player is better because his team is better, or whether a player is better because he's just so good by himself. And Russell Westbrook is just downright unstoppable by himself. Michael Jordan compares him to himself. He says, that's the guy in the NBA that's most like me. Just has that drive to compete and so forth. But the fact of the matter is that he puts up amazing numbers, but his team doesn't win a lot of the times. And same with James Harden. Plus, James Harden doesn't play defense. But anyway, what's really interesting right now is the Miami Heat look like they're going to make the playoffs. They're in the number 7 seed right now. But what's amazing about them is nobody's really that great on their team. In other words, some players are playing really well, but it's just 5 guys. Well, it's about 8 guys. And you just never know which one of them is going to produce in a particular night. But all of them are playing really well. They're a great team. And if you have to ask me which team I'd rather coach, I'd rather coach the Miami Heat. Because I'd rather coach a team than one guy that tries to carry a load on his own. Now you say, Pastor, I don't care about sports illustrations. Well, you know what? Sometimes the Apostle Paul used sports illustrations, the Olympic Games and so forth, and they really do make a good illustration of teamwork. You know, my coach in basketball and football in high school used to say, how many eyes are in team? You know, how many eyes are, I used to say something smart like, how many eyes are in win, or how many eyes are in whatever, but, you know, how many eyes are in, so. Anyway, but the point was is that it takes a team to be really a champion, to really have a great team. You need more than just one great player or 2 great players. You need 5 or 8. You need bench players. You need the whole team to play together and to play well. And the reality of it is that many churches have Russell Westbrook kind of, if you will, leadership or ministry. In other words, you've got a guy, he's really good at what he does. He's very dynamic. And perhaps compared to any one individual, he's way more talented, but he can only do so much by himself. And then you have a church that has, you know, a bunch of, maybe they don't have a Russell Westbrook, maybe a guy that's not completely unstoppable, but they have a whole bunch of people that are just really working together well, doing their different things. You know, it's good to have a good solid center. It's good to have some good power forwards. It's good to have some wing players, and it's good to have some point guards. You know, it's good to have those positions represented so that everybody is able, when their number is called or when their opportunity is there, to do it. And I fear that many times in the church, we have an MVP individualistic mindset with regard to doing the work of the Lord. In other words, here's a church at Rome, for instance, that has Jews and has Gentiles. And I would submit to you, based on the attitude of the Jews toward the Gentiles, that the Gentiles weren't really allowed to plug in and serve in that church. They were inferior Christians. And so if they had spiritual gifts, they weren't allowed to be used as much. But I want us to notice something in our text this morning, and I want us to really see, because this is the conclusion of all the things that we've been looking at about the law and about grace and about Israel and about the church. And now we're going to see, this is the way we're supposed to think. First of all, verse 3 is an amazing truth. Paul says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that's among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. In order for us to exercise our spiritual gift, the first thing we have to do is not to think anything more highly of ourselves than we ought to think. If grace is God's power, then how much credit can I take for what I accomplished with God's power?
Zero.
I mean, I'm an instrument. I'm a tool for God's power. So Hey, it's great to be used, but that's my privilege, not something for me to glory in. Okay, so how highly should a person think of themselves with regard to the gift that God has given them for the church? Well, it shouldn't be a thought. Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Anyone that thinks that because of their gift or because of their accomplishment in the church that they are important or preeminent in any means is a person who thinks too highly of themselves. And so we ought to think more highly of ourselves than we ought to think. So it's practical also, though, to understand that it's sufficient. Or I should say this. Because we're going to define the gifts today, we're not going to be able to mention a lot more about spiritual gifts, but it has to be sufficient to say that as the gifts are supernatural, we and others who are Spirit-filled are going to recognize these spiritual gifts in ourselves and each other. And so one of the things, I'm not going to spend a lot of time today, I'm not going to say, well, here's your spiritual gift and assign everybody their spiritual gift in the church. But suffice it to say that every one of us is, by God's grace, gifted to be part of the team, part of the church. I think many times as believers, we don't think much about that. In other words, what is my gift and where do I fit in the team? You didn't know your position. You didn't know what your job is, what your role is. And we'll get there, but I will point it out right now, a team player that doesn't show up for the game isn't much good. Right? In other words, having a team player that's benched or not at the game is not a team player who sees his role or his gift, God-given gift, as very important. And that's kind of a backwards mindset. It's also practical to understand that God gives gifts proportionately and thus will not be identically gifted. And also, we must not shirk our duty to exercise our gift in the church as it will be lacking without us. My friend, this morning, it does break my heart a great deal to just bare my soul for a moment that there are a lot of folks that ought to be here this morning that are not. Honestly, it grieves my heart this morning that people that ought to hear this message are not in the service. And I understand that sometimes there are good reasons, but I know that it's not a priority for most who are not here today. And that's grievous. Because the reality of it is that they do not see their duty as being part of the body as important. In other words, God's given them a grace, gift, a means and mode to serve Him in the church. And they've taken it. They've robbed us of that gift. In other words, it's not here. They're not here. It also grieves me to know how carelessly believers make decisions about involvement, just participating in churches' activities like outreach and worship, because a lot of times believers just aren't there. And it's as though they just don't realize that God has given them a grace gift, and they're part of the team, and they didn't show up for the game. I tell you, it's tough showing up for the game when the team doesn't come. It's hard to play the game without the team. And it's not a game, by the way, but we're performing a task that God's equipped us for. We need our pitcher, and we need our batters, and we need our basemen, and we need our outfielders, and we need our shortstops. We need to fulfill the positions for the job or the task, and many church members, believers, just don't think that their grace gift matters. They just take that away. I don't know how often we think in those terms when we consider forsaking the assembling. But that is the reality of what we've done in our mindset. We literally have said, God's gracious gift to me is not important to the team. Or what we are saying, not probably ever meaningfully saying or meaning to say, is, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me what God's doing. I'm not concerned about my responsibility for involvement. And so this is an important message, isn't it? We need each other, and the world needs us in order to fulfill God's plan. Did you hear me this morning? We need each other, and the world needs us to fulfill God's plan. I hope every one of us knows enough about the church to know that it is what God is using today. Listen, the church, my friend, is Jesus' idea. He established it, and He loves it. And many Christians, many believers, have plans other than the church to preach the gospel or to do outreach or whatever. But I'm going to tell you something. God's plan is the church. And if God's in love with it, so am I. If it's Jesus' idea, my friend, I don't mean to be condescending or unkind in saying your idea isn't better than Jesus' idea. And Jesus had the idea of the church. And he described the purpose of the church to the believers. That's the Great Commission. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always. Before Jesus ascended into heaven, he promised the believers, he talked to them about the kingdom, and then when they asked, is it time for the kingdom? He said, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has placed in his power, but you shall receive power. And he told them to wait at Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. And so they waited at Jerusalem, and the power of the Holy Spirit came down and equipped them to do the work of the church. And the Bible says as a result of that, they were added unto them daily such as should be saved. So I think every one of us ought to have at least a rudimentary understanding of the purpose of the church. It's a place that preaches the gospel. It is where the gospel goes out of. It's a team of gospel preachers, a church is. And it is a team which is empowered by the Holy Spirit of God. And it also fulfills the ministry of teaching believers to observe all things. What things? Everything the Bible says. And so it teaches the Word of God. That's what a church is. It's as simple as that. You know, we can say, well, a church is for evangelism and edification. Fine. It's a nice, you know, nice word with two E's. There are a couple E words to describe it, but the church is for the purpose of fulfilling the Great Commission. That's what the church does. And you, as part of the saved body of Christ, gifted by the grace that God has given you, are part of the team. And so our plan, our job, our task is... As a team, is to get a win, if you will. You say, well, what's a win? Well, the truth of the matter is we're not trying to lose. And sometimes you say, Pastor, you know, this whole talk about, you know, we need to grow the church, we need this. That's just all about the organization. No, my friend, we're trying to accomplish what God wants us to accomplish. And if the gospel has the ability to save to the uttermost all them that call upon the Lord, then we need to preach it to the uttermost. That's the Great Commission, to preach the gospel to the ends of the earth and to preach it particularly in our Jerusalem. And you're part of the Jerusalem team. And so we need to get the job done here. If the job isn't done, you can't say, well, you know, our pastor needs to do a better job. No, our church needs to do a better job. We're a team. It's our task, our duty, and we all need to know how we fit and belong in that. Okay, so we need each other. The world needs us to fulfill God's plan. And herein is a way that we can see the necessity of a healthy, organized church family. So let's look at the spiritual gifts. Okay, we need to understand that we ought to be part of a healthy, organized church family. You don't want injuries. You don't want players out. You want to be healthy, and you want to be organized so that everybody knows what they do. It's amazing teamwork. By the way, I don't watch NASCAR. I wouldn't mind driving a cup car. You know, racing in NASCAR, but I can't watch cars go in circles. I know there's a lot to it, and if you're a NASCAR fan here, are there any NASCAR fans here today? I really doubt it. Actually, no NASCAR fans here. Yeah, we have no NASCAR fans here today, so I'm not going to hurt anybody's feelings. But I'll tell you something. One of the things I do like to watch in NASCAR is when they pit the cars. Isn't that amazing? You ever watch when they pit the cars and they jack the thing up and the tires come off and the tires go on and the car drives off? It's like boom, boom, boom. I think it's like 8 seconds. That they can change the tires and make adjustments in the suspension, and everybody's out of the way and the car is off. Like, stops for 8 seconds, all four tires are changed, the suspension's adjusted, the car is fueled, and it's gone. And it's amazing. To me, the most amazing thing about NASCAR is the pit team, the pit crew. Because, I mean, literally, you win races by seconds. And so if a pit crew can get things done a quarter or a 16th of a second faster than another pit crew, you can win. Your team wins. Because of it. But I'll tell you something, literally every step is choreographed. It's the most beautiful dance you've ever seen. I don't like dancing, you know, so I like, if you're going to do choreography, a pit crew is my kind of a thing, folks. So anyway, the point is, it's absolutely amazing, isn't it? Isn't it incredible to watch? Like, man, they can change four tires, fill a car with gas, tune the suspension, and the driver's off. Sometimes people get run over, but I mean, most of the time, it happens, you know. That's pretty amazing. See, it's incredible to me that they can do that fast, and it's all about the team. And, I think that as a church, we ought to see the importance of organization, the importance of everybody having their place, knowing where they fit, where they belong, and stepping in and doing their job as efficiently and as effectively as possible so the church can perform and its purpose. Now, let's talk about the grace gifts. the Bible says that each of us, and that's what it says, have gifts that differ according to the grace that is given to us. As I mentioned in the beginning, one of the things we need to assume or understand is that our grace gift is not different. I'm going to propose some things about spiritual gifts at the end of the message, but I want to define the spiritual gifts right now. I think this is really important for us. So let's look at this. The Bible says, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Okay, so prophecy or prophecy. What is prophecy? Well, it's a discourse emanating from divine inspiration and declaring the purposes of God. Okay, so in other words, what is prophecy? Well, saying God says. God says. And that's important in the church, isn't it? To have somebody that says God says. We don't have time to teach about prophet or prophecy today, but the reality of it is that the Old Testament prophet and the New Testament gift of the prophet, and today the concept of prophecy, are not really very much changed or different. See, a prophet has always said, here's what God says. Oftentimes his message is one of warning. But it's important when the Bible says that if you have that gift of prophecy, that you prophesy according to the proportion of faith. That's an interesting statement, actually, isn't it? The burden of the prophet is truthfulness. The burden of the prophet, or one of the aspects of prophecy that's important, is whether it's truthful. You know, we don't have scripture that is written by lying prophets, but we have a lot of scripture written about lying prophets. In other words, there were more false prophets. There were more false prophets than there were true prophets of God. In any given age, in any generation, there were more individuals that were willing to say something that wasn't true than there were people that would say something true. Anytime a prophet would prophesy, you read Isaiah, you read Jeremiah, you read any of the prophets, anytime a prophet would say, thus saith the Lord, and he really was talking the mouthpiece for God, another prophet would come along and contradict him and say, thus saith the Lord, but they'd say what the people wanted to hear, or they'd give a more palatable or an alternative message. And the great burden of the person who says, thus saith the Lord, is to say the truth. To say the truth. I'm going to tell you something, it isn't easy. In other words, you have the gift of prophecy, I promise you. It's not one of those coveted gifts. It's not, hey, I want to be the guy that says, thus saith the Lord. Because usually what you say, thus saith the Lord, is about sin. Now, some folks are able to ignore themselves, not look at their own lives, and just look at others as a distraction, I think, oftentimes. Being willing to condemn others so they don't have to condemn themselves. But a prophet is a person who looks at himself and he looks to God and he looks at others and he says, thus saith the Lord. I believe every pastor ought to have the gift of prophecy. I don't think you could fulfill the preaching ministry without being a prophet in that sense, to say, thus saith the Lord. A pastor that won't tell you the truth, won't stand for truth, won't tell you when you're wrong, won't say, God says, is a man that isn't worthy of the office. He's a false prophet, if you will. So I believe one of the great burdens, and that's why the scripture says according to the proportion of faith. It's very interesting when you look at faith. A person who would prophesy according to the proportion of his faith. Well, what does Jesus say about faith? Well, was it Matthew 21? If you had faith of the grain of a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, be, as that's Luke that phrases it that way, be removed from thence and cast into the sea. When Jesus cursed the fig tree, remember he was going by the fig tree, it was out of season, the fig tree had no fruit, and Jesus said, no fruit on you forever. And they came back by at the end of the day, and the tree was dead. The leaves on it were withered. And they said, you cursed it, it's already dead. How'd you do that? And Jesus said, if you had faith, you could say to mountains, be moved and cast into the sea. And so the proportion of the faith, the Bible says a person who's a prophet has to have faith. Well, my friend, it goes without saying, or I think it should logically follow anyway, that a person who has faith knows God's promises, knows God's word. And so one of the requirements for the gift of the prophet would be a person is gifted in knowing God's word. In other words, thus saith the Lord. What does God say? And then as a person who believes God takes him at his word. We need the prophet in our church, don't we? We need people to say, God says. By the way, not just this is wrong, but a prophet also has vision to see what God will do. We need some people to say, God can save souls. Here's what the Word of God says about it. The Bible says that the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he'll send forth laborers. In other words, if we had enough laborers, we'd have harvest. Because there's no problem with the harvest, it's just a matter of getting folks out to bring it in. If we preach the gospel, people will be saved. Listen, if folks believe that, they show up for soul winning on Tuesday night. And say, hey, people are going to get saved this Tuesday. I want to tell you something. If all the folks in this room showed up Tuesday night, people would get saved. You think God in heaven who sends us to preach the gospel isn't going to send us to someone that will receive it when the harvest is plenteous? See, a prophet knows God's word, knows the promises of God's word, and has the faith to believe it and encourage others to follow. Gift of prophecy. Let's move forward. Ministry. Well, folks, I'm sorry. I know that I'm aware of the time right now. And I'll be honest with you. Every time I preach spiritual gifts, I preach long messages, and I've divided this passage up in a small place as I possibly can. Let's move along as quickly as we can. And I think I spent longer than I intended on our introduction this morning. But let's stay in tune because this is so important. So a spiritual gift that you may have is the gift of prophecy. Or the Bible says, or ministry. Let us wait on our ministering. Now, the word ministering is not a title. It is the word that we get our word deacon from, diakonos, and it simply means a servant, a servant. And I'll be truthful with you, some people maybe are better servants than others, but most servants have a motivation for serving. You ever go to the restaurant, you see a waiter or a waitress that's really trying for a tip? I appreciate when I go to a restaurant, there's a waiter or a waitress who's really good at the job. In other words, they just do their job. You walk in, and you get seated. And as soon as you get seated, they find out what you like to drink, and they bring your water to you right away. You know, and then you don't ever have to ask for a refill if you run out of water. It's just always there. In other words, they don't say, oh, your glass is empty. Would you like more? No. I mean, when they say your glass is empty, yeah, sometimes I'm a kind of a rude guest sometimes. I'll rattle my ice cubes or, you know, suck on the straw, you know, make loud noises, let people know I'm thirsty. And Taj does this. Oh. But I can't do that. When my glass is empty, I don't really need anyone to ask me the question. I mean, water's pretty cheap in our day and age, and I don't mean to belittle anyone that lives somewhere where water isn't easy to come by, but it really is not such a commodity that they can just put as much of it as I could drink in my glass, and even more than I could drink, it would be okay. And so one of the things I watch for in service is, you know, don't ask me if I need a refill. If it's empty, fill it, right? You don't ask me to more. What if I don't drink it? You know, well, you know, rinse the dishes with it or something, you know, or put it back into the ozone or put it in the ecosystem and it can pick up some particles from yoga pants and poison fish. And so, I don't know if y'all read the yoga pants article last week, but anyway, yoga pants are killing the environment. That's what I found out last week. So I've always known there's something wrong with them, but I just couldn't figure out what it was. But the particles, I'm trying to wake you five guys up by being funny for just a minute, okay? Particles of polyester are getting in from washing machines, are leaching through the filtration systems, or the plants that clean the water. Particles of polyester are making it through, and they're getting into our oceans, and they're getting into fish. And you're eating yoga pants, and you eat seafood. So it's bad, this yoga pants thing, folks. I'm telling you, it's out of control. So that'll preach it. That's a news article. All the major news media ran. There's no news last week. I guess Donald Trump didn't do anything very funny last week. So it was yoga pants. Anyway, so... all right, so how far away did I get from where we were at? Going off about that. Okay.
Oh, snaps at the waiters.
Okay. Yeah, Taj snaps at waiters. Yes, Taj does do that. Okay, so the thing is that when it comes to ministering or ministry, a real servant is a wonderful gift, and I don't think it's natural for us. I don't think it's very natural for us to go unnoticed, for us to... simply do the task or the job for the purpose of completing the task or the purpose of fulfilling our part of the team, serving. And I don't know what God's percentage numbers are, but I would say there are more that are supposed to be part of that, filling that position in the team, than perhaps there are prophets. In other words, you know, there needs to be a lot of servants, don't they? In other words, a servant just sees the task, My wife always says, a need seen is a task assigned. It's so frustrating when you try to lead ministry and people come and tell you things that need to be done as though you're not aware of it. You know, you just can't do everything, but people always tell you, Pastor, you need to do this. You know, as though, oh, I got nothing going on, you know, maybe you should do, you know, if you see it, do it. That's what a servant does. And I'll tell you something, one of the ways to know that God has gifted you is if you're gifted at seeing needs, then you know that you are a servant. In other words, you're not the person who tells people what the need are. If God showed you the need, He just gave you a place to serve. And so we need to think of this as part of the team of fulfilling the work of the body of Christ. A lot of things that need to be done. And we need to be ministers. Nothing's more unnatural, probably, for most than this spiritual gift. Because we are self-serving, not other-serving, by nature. Some more so and less so than others, but it's in our nature to do things with a motive of self-reward. And so nothing is, however, more practical or better received than the spiritual gift. I'm going to tell you something. You don't have arguments with servants. People that are just serving, they're not the folks that have conflict. They're just serving. They're just doing what needs to be done. I went on a missions trip one time. We had like three different general contractors on this mission trip and like two or three of us that were just there to help. I'm going to tell you something. The GCs argued the whole time. And they spent the first day arguing. I finally just started going and doing stuff. I was like, well, you know what? I know this can be done. That can be done. And you know how we got the job done? We just started working. And finally, a couple of them just said, okay, if we're never going to get done arguing about the best way or the right way or whatever, we're going to get done by doing the job. And everybody needs those guys to serve. And so if God's given you the grace to minister, you are a gift that's welcomed and well-received. Isn't that a great thing? Maybe a prophet, that's not always what everybody wants. But everybody wants a servant. That'd be a great team member to have, wouldn't it? Third one, teacher. The Bible says, he that teacheth, verse 7, on teaching. So if your gift is teaching, then you ought to teach. Teach, what is it? It's the word we get our didactos word from, or didactic means teaching. But it means to instruct or to hold a discourse with others in order to instruct them, to deliver didactic discourses. Now let me just say about this spiritual gift that there are more individuals that think they're teachers perhaps than are great by God's grace made to be teachers. And let me explain it this way. In other words, you may be called to teach, but if you're not a good teacher, it's probably not your spiritual gift. At one time in our church, it was like we really had people that resented that they didn't get to teach, because I mean everybody can't teach at the same time, or we'd all have a class with no one in it. And one of the things that I've always determined is if you teach and no one will come to hear your teaching, then you perhaps aren't a good teacher. Or maybe what you're teaching isn't, you know, it isn't always the topic that isn't good, but maybe you're not a good teacher. You say, Pastor, well, people ought to want to learn. Yes, they ought to, but you have to teach them to want to learn. You got to feed people. You got to give people enough to make them hungry to learn. And so I think that perhaps this is one of the most frequently desired offices by those who love preeminence. People who want to be up front, they want to have attention, or they resent authority themselves and they don't want to be under teaching. I know many people that teach so they don't have to be taught. In other words, if I don't teach, then I'm going to have to sit there and I don't want to be here. You don't want to learn. And a teacher ought to be a learner as well. And I would say this, it's a frequently desired office, but it is measured in effectiveness, preparation, and the ability to overcome the obstacles of teaching. A good teacher overcomes the obstacles of teaching, like, for instance, people sleeping while you're preaching, like folks are right now. Inattentiveness, disinterest, spiritual blindness, and so forth are all things that people who have God's grace will overcome to be teachers. In other words, here's the teacher's mindset. Teacher's mindset is everybody needs to know this. Right? Well, if everyone needs to know it, but some people don't know they need to know it, or don't care that they need to know it, or aren't learning it, what am I supposed to do as a teacher? I'm supposed to figure out how to teach it to them. Actually, you know, my wife is a teacher. She is a teacher, the most gifted teacher I've ever met. Every Christian school she's ever taught in, she's teacher of the year. People come in. I remember principals bringing teachers in. I want you to watch Mrs. Price in her classroom. She speaks in a very soft voice. She doesn't even have the ability to yell. And yet, the kids like sit up, pay attention, listen to everything she says, and she gets it across. She's a good teacher. You know, one of the things that makes her a good teacher is that she overcomes the obstacles to teaching. She knows her students. She knows what the things that are going, she knows what's going on with them. And she figures out, based on what's going on with them, how to teach them. And a good teacher does that. If you have the gift of teaching, you're not going to be content to say, well, I stood up and I said everything. I presented the material. A teacher is not one who presents material. A teacher is one who teaches people the truth. It's a gift. It's a spiritual gift. By the way, I think pastors ought to have that gift. Don't you agree? I think a pastor ought to be a prophet. I think a pastor ought to be a teacher as well. Okay? Matter of fact, in Ephesians chapter 4, speaking of spiritual gifts, they're one and the same, pastors and teachers. It's interesting that they're mentioned in a grammatical construction where one is the other and the other is the one. Pastor is a teacher. Not every teacher is a pastor, but every pastor is a teacher. That's the assumption of the office of pastor in Ephesians chapter 4. Moving forward. You must be able as a teacher to diagnose areas of ignorance and to bring people to a place of understanding regardless of whether they are readily teachable or not. Come back real quick, will you please? That's one of the reasons this passage of Scripture needs to be preached in our church. The fact of the matter, folks, is I believe one of the reasons we have such a lack of involvement in our church members is because we don't see the importance of spiritual gifts. And I'll tell you, this is a heavy burden to preach this message today. We must learn about spiritual gifts, or our church will not accomplish the work that God wants us to accomplish. This is important. I know I'm preaching a long time today, but man, this is an important message. We've got to learn it. We've got to overcome it. We've got to participate in thinking it through and understanding. And so we need to bring people to a place of understanding, regardless of whether they're readily teachable or not. And a good teacher understands and relates to his pupils and goes to any length to convey truth and enlighten understanding. Whatever it takes, that's what a teacher says. They need to know it. I'm the one who's supposed to teach it. So what will I do in order to get them to learn it? Anything. Test your pupils. Find out what they know. Find out what they've learned. Find out what's going on. Diagnose it. A teacher is a diagnostician. I just made a new word. It's kind of like, what is that word we made up in Sunday school today? Sixistence? Sixistence. Yeah. So diagnostician. So one who diagnoses things. Diagnostic technician. Anyway, that word exists now. So, all right, let's move forward. Exhortation. Now, exhortation is not the same. Verse 8, he that exhorteth to exhortation. Exhortation is a fascinating, important word. Exhortation means to call or to summon one to come alongside. There is no greater word to describe equality in Christ, being one in Christ, than exhortation. In other words, the very idea of exhortation is no one left behind. In other words, if I've taken a spiritual step, I'm going to exhort others to take the same step. If I've reached a new height or a new place, I'm going to bring others up with me. And I'm going to exhort people. In other words, I'm not going to be content for other people to be average or to be less and just say, well, you know, that's how the cookie crumbles, you know. I mean, when God predestinated us to be conformed to the image of His Son, His image was different for some of us. No, my friend. If we're predestinated to be conformed to the image of His Son, we've got to exhort each other. Exhort each other. So much the more as you see the day approaching. That's the exhorting, the gift of exhortation. That's some of this is, listen, I know what you're going through. I understand that life is busy and things are hard. But friend, just as much as this is important for me, it's important for you, and we've got to take this step. He's an encourager. He's one that grabs somebody's hand and brings them up, brings them alongside, that holds somebody to a higher place or a higher level or a higher standard and helps them to be more than they would be without that grace gift. Now, practically speaking, we would have to say that the teaching and the exhortation would be gifts that are exercised among the body, wouldn't we? In other words, you could say, well, bring a person to salvation. That'd be more the gift of the prophet. But exhortations for the body is saying, guys, mediocrity, no, none of us can be there. We've got to grow. We've got to come together. We've got to take the next step. We've got to come alongside. If I can, so can you. Exhortation. Okay? The gift, the Bible says, giving. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. Best illustration of that is when Jesus talked about in Matthew 6. Take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Gift. You're supposed to give with simplicity. In other words, you just give. There's no fanfare. There's no blowing a trumpet. There's no, you know, making sure that you get your recognition. I've known individuals that were, in men's eyes, big givers, but they were well known for their giving. And the very idea of giving with simplicity is just get it done. Don't make a big deal out of it. You know, there are givers that come into the church that want you know, some accolades. They want a plaque on a building, or they want somebody to recognize them, or you to crawl through some hoops. I've had people come, you're going to be mad at me about this, I've had people offer to buy us a church building before. No kidding. Hey, pastor, I'll buy you a church building. I said, well, great, let's talk to the church about it. I don't need to talk to them. If I want to buy it, I'm going to buy it where I want it, how I want it, and so forth. And I said, as long as it's okay with our church. And that nixed it. Because they wanted to have credit for the idea, for the means, for the method, and so forth. And I'll just tell you something, I respect the body too much. I'd rather be here. I'm thankful for this place, aren't you? I'm thankful for what God can provide with God's people. In other words, they couldn't just come and put the money in the offering plate. I want to give for something. Say, well, put the money in the offering plate, we'll do it. Well, no, I want to make sure it goes. Well, that's what it'll go for. That's what we need. If we have the money, we'll do it. No, you can't give with simplicity. You can't just give. Part of the team, and we can't let the body make decisions. You know, we've got to make sure that I control things. You know, that's not giving with simplicity. The gift of giving is giving. Just give. And you just do it. You've got the gift. Giving by God's grace, then do it, the Bible says, with simplicity. Boy, that's a good illustration. The Bible goes on to say, by the way, I'm nearly done. A ruler. Now, this is interesting. This is a gift of ruling. I know all of you want this gift. But again, promise you this, if you like to be popular, you won't want to rule. ruling really is prostemi, which is to set or place before, or to set over, or to be over and superintend or preside over. Or literally, a synonym would be the word guardian. Guardian. In other words, if you have a person who's not yet of age, his guardian makes important decisions for him to protect him from self-harm, to rule over, to preside. I do believe that would be a pastor, one of the shepherding aspects of a pastor. But I've known pastors that aren't the ruler in the ministry. Very, very large ministries. But I've known where the pastor maybe is the preaching, he's the prophet. He's the exhorter, but maybe somebody else is kind of they run the thing. You know, they take care of things, they organize and they plan and so forth. You say, pastor, I don't know about that. Well, that's just fine. I've just seen it work very well in some places where maybe the pastor isn't the ruler, but usually in a small church, usually it's a few people that are leading things or ruling over. And it's really interesting, actually, when you look at the word. The best illustration I can think of is when Solomon was asked by God to ask for anything. You remember what his answer, what his prayer was to God? Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and evil, or good and bad, for who is able to judge this so great a people? In other words, a person who has a great humility about the responsibility of ruling over something. So I believe that inherent to the gift of grace to rule is the understanding of not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Sometimes the guy calling the shots thinks he's smarter or more intelligent or whatever, and he's not. He simply has God's grace to do that task or perform that task. It doesn't make it more important. Last gift, mercy. Mercy. This is, and I know I've gone way over this morning. You have to forgive me. Will you forgive me? Who has the gift of mercy here this morning? Okay, let's be merciful, shall we? Okay, this is, I believe, along with the word love, one of the most misused words or concepts. Because what people define mercy as, oftentimes, is willingness to overlook sin. Right? And I ever said, well, you know, I'm serious. You know, you take a spiritual gifts test, and one of the things a spiritual gifts test will say is, do you have a tendency when somebody does something that the Bible says is wrong, you know, to want to, you know, be merciful to that person? The very idea of that notion assumes that God, who said sin is what it is unmerciful and that you are merciful. Yeah. And that is the most arrogant notion. Right. Matter of fact, it really, that's one that makes me angry. I'll be honest with you. Is anyone who would say, God says it's wrong, but I think we should be merciful. Do you see where I'm going with this? Whereas that is literally what they're saying. God condemns it. Me, not so much. I think God's a little harsh on this one. It's dangerous, isn't it?
Yeah.
If God can, God's against it, so am I. I love that one of the statements of Reformers Unanimous, and I think it just fits so many things. God, if God's against it, so am I. That's not mercy. But a person who's merciful is one who looks for someone who would be downtrodden, outcast, and extends to them a mercy that would not probably be extended normally or naturally. He's a person who sees someone that everyone else would see as hopeless and wants to help them anyway and believes they can help them. A merciful person is a person who's very effective of bringing people to a place that they would not otherwise have come. And he is very, very well connected with the exhorter. As a matter of fact, I think sometimes that's an overlapping spiritual gift. A person who's merciful is a person that says, no, everybody can do it. Everybody can make it. And other people say, well, except for that guy. And he says, no, that guy. And reaches out. That's a gift of mercy. My friend, long-suffering and mercy are the one of the preeminent attributes of God. And so this is a person, by God's grace, who really models what God says. When we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. When I look at things as much as I'm able to, humanly speaking, from God's perspective, my conclusion is scrap the whole deal. Man is not worth saving. But God gave His Son. And He did so in a very righteous, just, holy way. See, He did not say that righteousness was not righteousness. He simply offered a sacrifice. Himself. So a merciful person is a person who is very prone to self-sacrifice. Because that's the characteristic as modeled by our God. One who says, yes, this is right, but I'll do anything to help you get right. Mercy. That's it for the spiritual gifts, so let's have our conclusion. You ready for it? I'll see if I can read it. The diversity of these gifts is what makes a well-rounded church. If we had all rulers, if we had all exhorters, if we had all prophets, if we had all givers, if we had all mercy. By the way, we have to understand that I'm going to list about three things about these important truths. First of all, the danger is that often churches are formed around the personality of one gift. Some churches are known for their giving. You understand what I'm saying? Some churches are known for their teaching. Some churches are known for their charity or their mercy. Some churches are known for their exhortation. But the fact of the matter is, Paul is talking to one local church and saying, these gifts belong in your church, all of these gifts. The inherent danger is that oftentimes there is an attraction of us to those who have been given the same spiritual gift. In other words, if you're an exhorter, you want to go to the exhortation church. But actually, you need to go to the not exhortation church. If you're a prophet, you want to go to the prophet church. But actually, you need to go to the church that doesn't have a prophet. We tend to try to congregate around those who are like us. And oftentimes, I believe in the body of Christ, in the local aspect, many times, the diversity of the spiritual gifts is not diverse at all. Because we want to be around those who are like us. Why would we tend toward that? Well, I think, first of all, because of a misunderstanding of the team aspect of spiritual gifts. Now, who wants to go to the place to be the servant? Who wants to go to the place where there isn't a prophet? See, anytime you go to one of these places, you're needed. And you've got a task. And you're part of the team. And if it's missing in the church, you're what's missing. And my friend, our tendency to shirk and to be lazy and irresponsible or just uncommitted, oftentimes precludes us from exercising our spiritual gift. Many churches have all the givers. Many churches have all the exhorters, all the prophets, all the whatever, because the folks don't want to be part of the team. They want to be around a place where they feel as though they fit. A sure sign that you have a spiritual gift is that nobody else does, and you see the need for it. Now, I'm not going to go through all the how to know your spiritual gift. I'm just telling you something. Why don't they have that? It so frustrates me. That church does not. We don't reach out to the poor. Well, because the gift of mercy is griping about not having it instead of doing it. Why doesn't anybody give for blah, 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 blah? Because the person who has the gift of giving is looking for someone else to give. Why doesn't someone say something about, because the guy who is the prophet wants someone else to do the job? You see. And so practically speaking, one of the first caveats or dangers of spiritual gifts is that even when we recognize our spiritual gift, we want to congregate with those around us who are like us, and as such, we want to be like third string members on a bench. But we don't want to be players on the team. And my friend, God didn't call you to be bench warmers. God called you to be starters, players, fulfilling your spiritual gift. Secondly, more conclusion. I got a lot of conclusion. Each of these gifts is an opportunity to fulfill the commission of the church. Every one of these gifts ultimately accomplishes what the church is supposed to accomplish. We established what that was, didn't we? You may be a servant. Your purpose in serving is to see people come to Christ and to grow in their faith. You may be an exhorter. Your purpose in exhortation is to see people come to Christ and to grow in the faith. And as you examine each gift, you can see how each of these work to do the same thing. In other words, I don't care if the basket's shot from the three-point line, from the free throw line, from a layup, or dunked. The poor purpose is to get the ball in the hoop. All the different ways. Gospel isn't different, but the spiritual gifts are different to reach different people. And to grow people to reach different people. Third, each of these gifts are working gifts. And I have in parentheses, working gifts. In other words, work is work. Work requires effort, sweat, discipline, preparation, training, and faithfulness. Working gifts. You have a gift of grace. When you are saved, God gifted you with His grace. And you are currently gifted by God's grace. And so you have a job as part of the team. It's a job. It's work. You say, Pastor, I didn't come to church to be told I got to work. This is my day off. Not today. Working gift. It is not coincidental, though, that the prayer warrior is not listed among the spiritual gifts. Do you ever see in the Bible prayer as a spiritual gift? Anywhere? You ever think about that? Sure. Now, I'm not going to preach what isn't in the Bible today. I'm just going to point out to you it isn't in the Bible. That prayer is a spiritual gift. Well, I believe that's for a couple of reasons. First of all, we're all supposed to pray. Right. We're all supposed to pray. But I believe oftentimes prayer warrior is a cop-out. See, the fact of the matter is that some may not have the health to minister. Right? Isn't it so? I mean, if ministering is serving or performing a task that's needed for someone else, maybe we don't have the physical ability to do that. You may not have the health to minister, but it is a practical and simple observation that the other gifts are mostly a matter of words or commitment. In other words, I don't know many people in bad health who cannot speak sometimes. Some cannot, but they can usually communicate somehow. And most of these gifts are communication gifts. Mercy can be communicated. Giving can be communicated oftentimes. Exhortation can be communicated. Prophecy can be communicated. In other words, if you can speak, you can serve. And so many times individuals will say, well, Pastor, and they'll give me a reason why they cannot perform their duty as a spiritual gift, and they'll say something like, you know, I'm a prayer warrior. I'm going to pray for the people that are doing the work. It isn't a spiritual gift. you're supposed to pray anyway. I could pray. You know, I'm not going to preach a message about this. We don't have time for it. But I don't often ask people to pray for things. Because I can. Right? I'm not saying there isn't value in corporate prayer or agreeing in prayer. It's great to open a service with all of us agreeing that we want God to bless us with His presence, that we want Him to receive our worship, and that we want the Holy Spirit to be among us. It's great to agree in prayer, isn't it? But I'm telling you, the prayer that gets things done is when one-on-one we go to God and we ask for things. And all of us are supposed to do that. That isn't a spiritual gift. That's a command. We're supposed to pray. God wants everybody to pray. Okay, so I just want to tell you, don't make that a cop-out. Don't say, well, I'm past the age of being able to. No, you are not. You're living. You're breathing. You have God's grace. And if you do not get on the floor and play the game, you're a shirker. Okay, not very nice, but I'm going to finish. It's dire health indeed that would preclude us from using our voices to channel the grace that God supernaturally gives. Is this so? Okay. Third, or fourth, or whatever it is. If these gifts are the means for our church to fulfill its purpose, how vital must be our time to pray and identify our gift or gifts? I'm not going to do it to you today, but if I were to ask every person, what is your gift and how are you using it? What is your spiritual gift and how are you using it? It actually is a rather tragic idea that I assume that many of us do not know or could not answer that question. Sometimes as a prophet, it's my duty to point out things that are very wrong. And it is very wrong if in the church you do not know what your spiritual gift is and how you are exercising it. Because it simply means that either you're a bench warmer or you don't even see yourself on the team. And it's very important that we know and that we use our spiritual gifts. Okay? And then let me say this. I think this goes without saying, but we'll say it because sometimes things are not understood unless they're stated. A church without members is lacking in spiritual gifts. Remember when we started our church, one of the first things, it's one of the first messages I wanted to preach to our church when we started our church. So I wanted our people to know that we're not a one-man band. You know, when people say your church to me, it's an insult. It's not my church. It's ours. We're part of this body. And if you're not exercising your spiritual gift, a church that doesn't have people is lacking spiritual gifts. We're lacking some this morning, folks, let me just tell you. Okay. A proportion of grace should, this is another point, and I have one more after this. A proportion of grace should certainly allow for more than one gift or period of giftedness. And let me just present this by way of a concept for you as well. And I know everybody's so tired and I've gone so long, and I realize it. Unless you're practicing your spiritual gift, it's doubtful whether you know what it is, even if you have known in time past. Do you understand what I mean by that? It may be that because of the place you are called to serve, God has supernaturally equipped you to serve there, but if you're no longer in that place, you may no longer have God's supernatural equipping for the service there. I've seen it happen in churches where God used somebody for a space or period of time, and then God brought someone else in, and He began using them instead. And so then that person either moved forward or moved into a different place. And it was amazing that, you know, they were good here and they're good here. Well, how is that so? Well, because this person recognizes that if God could give me grace to teach, God could give me grace to exhort. If God could give me grace to exhort, He could give me grace to be merciful. If God could give me grace to be merciful, I could be a giver. And by the way, no single spiritual gift precludes having more than one. If you had to choose one for me, wouldn't that be frustrating? I would like to have a pastor with one spiritual gift. You know, I'd want a pastor with the gift of giving. If I were going to pick up kids. I mean, which one? You want a pastor as a teacher or one who's a prophet? Or you want one who's an exhorter? Or you want one who's merciful? Or you want one who's a giver? Or you want one... In other words, you'd like to see all that from your pastor, wouldn't you? Yeah. So then why wouldn't a member, why would a member ever say something that's like, that's not my spiritual gift? Shouldn't say that. You should ask God. And again, sometimes a need seems a task assigned or something you could pray and ask God's grace for. In other words, I believe this. I'm not trying to teach something new or something something extra biblical, but I believe you could pray for a spiritual gift if God needed it. I have. I've been insufficient in many things in my life, and I've asked God for grace, and He's given it to me. And I think that's a real encouragement at this stage in the message, don't you? Yeah, okay. And then, if a church needs a spiritual gift, might it not be acceptable to the gracious giver, that's God, to endow as needed for such a time as needed? Sometimes we get so locked into a spiritual gift, and our time expires, but we don't. And we just stay locked in that channel, and we're unbending, and we're unmoving, and God can't do anything else with us because we're stuck on what we were. And we need to be looking at God's plan today in the present, living in the present tense for the future with regard to spiritual gifts. That's all, folks. I've preached the whole message. I've got through my conclusion and everything. And I do think it's an important message. And I'm going to challenge the folks that weren't here this morning to listen to this, because I believe this is a key to a healthy, vibrant, effective church. And don't we want to be a healthy, effective, vibrant church? Don't we want to serve the Lord Jesus and please Him in every way? Right. And so, in one sense, I feel apologetic for taking so much of your time today. But in another sense, I feel as though this is so important that every one of us ought to really take more time, at least personally, to evaluate what is God doing? What is my spiritual gift? How do I fit? How do I belong? And what is God doing with me? In other words, what's my role in the team? Father, thank You for what You've taught us today. We thank You so much, and we just ask in Jesus' name that You would bless the truth of it in our hearts. And Lord, I just ask that You would lead each person to apply the truth today in a way that would be practically not only understood, but lived for the rest of their lives. We ask in Jesus' name. Now, friend, I would say this today before we conclude our service. I want to have an invitation, but it's not going to be a come-forward invitation. I'd be embarrassed if I heard a message like this and I didn't respond. And so I think this would be one of those come everyone invitations if we had a come forward invitation this morning. Every one of us is supposed to practice, live out our spiritual gift. And so this morning, instead of having a come forward invitation, I'd ask that you would take time. I'm just going to take just a minute of silence. And that you do business with God. Maybe ask God the question, God show me, or God teach me, or simply a prayer of surrender. God, I surrender. I will take this matter and I will do something with the material that You've showed me from Your Word today with the truth that's been preached. Should we do that? Why don't I lead in a prayer like that? Father, Lord, what we've seen today, what I've seen from Your Word convicts me. I'm convicted for myself and I'm convicted for our church. So I pray, Lord, that You would impress this truth upon us so strongly and that You would burden us with the responsibility of it in such a way that we make no excuses and we do not shirk. And we see ourselves as vital, Lord, that we recognize that if You've given us grace, then You haven't given it to someone else. And so if we withhold it, we are defrauding our brethren. I pray that You would help us with this concept, with this understanding. And Lord, help us to practically learn it in such a way that we can exhort others and that we can bring others alongside. And ultimately, God, so that first we please You, and secondly, so that we effectively reach the lost world for Jesus. And we pray in His name. Amen. You're dismissed. Wow. Don't look at the time. It's early.